brothers and sisters, all friends of John Mahoney. When we look at the dates, it will be 1938 to 2012. But I'm going to spend a few minutes and focus on the hyphen, the time he spent with us. And whenever I think of John Mahoney, a smile always will come to my face, because there will always be a story behind John Mahoney. In preparing for this, I had to review my catalog, as all of you have had to review your catalog of John Mahoney stories. And I've discovered there are three basic buckets of John Mahoney stories for me. The first were the unique to John Mahoney stories, those that only he could somehow or other experience in this odyssey of his. For example, does everyone know what the particular shade of green that the Dublin taxi driver was asking him about? The second set of stories are sort of our shared history. Oftentimes, John would be telling a story and he'd be sitting there listening and saying, wait a minute, I was in that moment. I don't remember exactly. But somehow it was a more expansive, fuller, gentler sharing of history than you were. Then there were the third set of stories. And these were the ones that, if they weren't true, they should have been true. Because they were just great stories. But you know, if you're a storyteller, sometimes you're so much more, and the stories are part of the life that he's sharing with you. And in John's case, it wasn't bragging at all, because he did all these crazy things. And for so many of us in this room, he became a mentor, counselor, advisor, certainly a philosopher, a teacher. He had classrooms in Syracuse, in the District of Columbia, in Virginia, in Maryland, and a few hundred members of Congress, in Limerick, and sometimes we all sort of came together in the same classroom. He was one of those teachers who was always a phone call or a cup of coffee away. And his advice was always simple, direct, and by and large, I usually followed him. I first got to know John and Mary in 1974. In 1982, I had this young woman on my arm, and we were at a party, and we were about to take a trip to Ireland. And she goes running up to John, who's been traveling to Ireland a number of times, and says, so John, what should we do when we're in Ireland? And John at the time sort of gave me one of those famous Mahoney stares. I knew there was a thought process somewhere back there. And then he just looked at me and said, Mary. Something really represented to him. And my family got so we could read all the quotations and see all the photographs and see how this church was organized in a way that really reflected to us John's spirit. And John's spirit was perfectly captured in the gospel, because it was give back. It was be part of something. It was, regardless of your economic situation, you could help others. And that was John Mahoney. Now, if anyone didn't know, John was a Democrat. Some people. It was part of his DNA. You could not have a conversation with John without talking about Democratic politics and what the election, whatever election it was, meant to the future of the country and the community. He represented a politics that was civil, that was never mean-spirited, that was never had the tough edge to it that our politics seems to have today. He had many, many Republican friends. And as the members of the clergy can understand, he could hate the sin, but love the sinner. And he had always hopes of redemption. But politics was a sport. It was a game. It was part of the life. And there was never a final chapter to it. In my experience, this was particularly shown to me in early 1980, where John had engineered a vote and won the vote. And out of the speaker's office came one Thomas P. O'Neill, who saw John, and for the benefit of the clergy, this is going to be an abridged version of what the speaker said. But basically, I heard, Mahoney, you're in the doghouse with me. It was abridged. A few months later, I was organizing a Democratic fundraiser, and the speaker was the guest. This involved the weekend in Florida. And John figured out that his friend Bill would get him an invitation to the fundraiser. And I watched this master spend the weekend slow, inch by inch, working his way back into the speaker's good graces. So finally, we're at the Saturday night dinner, and there's a little music. And Tip and Millian are dancing, and John and Mary are dancing, and they're laughing and going back and forth. And then Tip says, wait a minute. And suddenly everyone stops. Tip looked and said, I'm mad at you. And John looked innocent, shocked. Speaker said, I can't remember why. That's John. Somewhere in the travels, he gave me a PT-109 tie bar, which he told me was only to be worn on St. Patrick's Day. I'm making an exception, John. I'm wearing it today. Well, let me anchor with a little bit of a conversation about the two women who mean the most to John. And that's Mary and Kate. This is probably a story that I've never shared with them. But Kate had just been born. Mary was still in the hospital. And my mother and I came upon John in a place known as the Dubliner. A few people have met known John in the Dubliner. And he was sitting there, so we joined him. And the afternoon had two themes to it. The first was Mary, how beautiful Mary was, how wonderful she was, how important she is to me, how everything revolves around Mary, how loving she is, how forgiving she is. And then we changed to Kate, who was so precious and a miracle, and so small that she was just a newborn. were. We had to understand that she was very small. Then we go back to the conversation about Mary. It sounded familiar. How wonderful she was. How beautiful she was. Then we go back to the conversation about Kate. And after a few rounds of this conversation, thanks be to God.